It is the center of the great Bob Wilson, Robert Wilson, one of the great theater artists of all time, one of the grandmasters of theater. And we have with us in the beginning here, Elise Herget, who is the director at the moment, you know, of the Watermill Center. Elise, how are you? Can you hear me?
Hi, I'm good. I can hear you. How are you doing?
Good. I know Bob is in Texas, and hopefully we'll connect soon. And thank you for joining us, Elise. Tell us a little bit about Watermill Center. It has been, in a way, close also to a spirit, but what we do here at the Segal Center, or also BAM and St. Denis International Center. It's a global center, and through this you are connected and to the world. Tell us a little bit about Watermill.
Yeah, absolutely. So Watermill was founded in 1992 by Robert Wilson, the theater director and opera director. And we were founded as a laboratory for the arts. It was originally a Western Union facility, and kind of taking from that same energy, founded a laboratory and an incubator for experimentation and the creative process, really focused on creative thinking and exploring openly and having just a space and the time to explore. And we've, you know, over the past 30 years, I can't believe we're about to celebrate our 30th summer, we've really served a global community, inviting over 150 artists to create work each year at the Watermill Center. And from all over the world, we're generally serving about 35 different countries on an annual basis. And we host artist residency programs. Those are core programs and fellowships, but we also have a number of education programs. And really, it's a space to kind of create and to inspire as well.
Yeah, and I know you had to shut down in the time of Corona. You're slowly restarting.
We are, yeah. We've made some pretty substantial changes because of COVID. But, you know, we've really been able to ramp back up programming this year and last year. And right now we have six artists in residence, a Polish choreographer, dancer, a Greek sculptor, a New York-based visual artist, and then two dancers with the choreographer. Yeah. So we are still running residencies, which is great.
We're still running residencies. You have had, I think, many artists actually from the Eastern Europe over the decades, and your center is one of the few places also, like here, Art Center, which we had here today, or the institution I mentioned that opens. Why do you feel, why does Bob think that Watermill Center should be a global center, but it has to be, and not for American artists who also need, just for American artists who also need space and time and attention and encouragement?
Absolutely. I mean, I think for Bob, he's always, you know, he's been a global artist himself. He is the definition of an international artist, and takes a lot of influence from other cultures and other time periods. We have a large collection of works that span many, many cultures and, you know, go all the way back to 5000 BC and up to contemporary works that were made last week. You know, for him, really looking at the global footprint and being able to bring artists in from other cultural, with other cultural backgrounds, is a way for him to learn and to be curious and to create work as well. So we've, you know, one of our, let's say, guiding principles for the organization is to serve both our local community that is in and around Watermill and New York City, while also looking to a global community and working with a global community.
The situation in Ukraine, is this on your mind? This is on the mind of the staff, of the Watermill people? Is this influencing what you're doing?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, we've been trying to figure out ways that we can really step up and be able to work, especially with the artistic community in Ukraine, and knowing a number of, you know, artists who have remained in Ukraine to continue to support, and and to create work there has really influenced us in kind of how we're thinking about summer and going forward also into the fall of what we can do. So I've there are a couple different initiatives that we're hoping that we can be, you know, of service and help out in some way that we can. You know, we have this amazing facility, 10-acre property and an 8-bedroom house that we host artists in. So that's something that I'm really looking towards is, you know, if we can host a residency with Ukrainian refugees, with Ukrainian artists, to be able to support their practice and support them just in general. But then looking more also towards just the emergency relief of, the current moment. I think there's somewhat of a dual initiative there of trying to figure out how the Watermill Center can really position ourselves to be as helpful as possible.
Yeah. Did you have Ukrainian artists in the past?
We have had a few during the summer program over the years. We have a number of supporters. You know, the Long Island community, there's a really big Ukrainian community within Long Island. So we have a number of community members and local artists that we've worked with who had immigrated from Ukraine a number of years ago. And so that's, I've kind of turned to that community to really figure out where we can best be helpful in this moment. There's two women specifically that I'm kind of working with through, and they're in touch with about 20 artists who are actively living and working in Ukraine right now, mostly in Kyiv. And so that's kind of where we're kind of looking, but we don't have a super, you know, every summer we had about, let's say 70 artists coming, representing about 30 countries. So there were a couple of Ukrainian artists who came through that program.
That is amazing. I'm sure, I think the Bob is in Texas somewhere, and hopefully it will be connected to join us. And I think he looks like he's just entering the waiting room.
Oh, good.
And we are so grateful. I know you also prepared a reading, right? You have a Tal Adnan poem, which you will read to us. But let's first say hello to Bob. Bob, can you hear us?
Hi, Frank. Good morning.
How wonderful and lovely that you join us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bob, we started at 10 o'clock and we will have, as you know, 12 hours of programming with 24 New York theater organizations, from BAM, the Brooklyn Academy, where you will present your beautiful work, The Shed, Sangdance Warehouse, Here Art Center, and many, many others. And we, of course, included Watermill Center, which is such an important institution, perhaps not as fully known as it should be. We ask you to read some of the text, but if I can ask the question first, what does it mean to you as an artist in the world, and one of the great artists, one of the grandmasters ever in the theater, to create work in a time of war?
Well, I think that it's more necessary than ever for artists to create work. And it's a way where people come together, and irregardless of political beliefs or religious beliefs, or those things will always separate men. But art can serve the unique function of bringing people together, where people share something for a brief moment. That is one of the special things that art can do.
You created that work, that brilliant work, The Civil Wars. And it also looked at the history of wars, and in a way, Russians shooting at the Ukrainians, who they want to be liberated as brothers and get back, but they are shooting them. Tell us a bit, why did you create, what was the idea for you to do this massive, also global work for civil wars?
Well, my production of Civil Wars was any kind of civil strife. So So a child learning to tie his shoes, or someone learning to walk, someone learning to speak. So it included many things, but the experience of learning. And so it was any kind of civil strife. That was the underlying theme. And it wasn't necessarily war with guns. And
mm-hmm. But it looked at many, many conflicts. As someone said, the opposite of...
Turned back to Abraham Lincoln.
Yeah.
Lincoln was not a popular president at his time. It was only after, sometimes years after his death, that he was acknowledged as being a great man. And so it was reflecting on, I had as a subtitle, "A tree is best measured when it's down." It's an old American folk saying, and it had a lot to do with the American Civil War and the emancipation of slaves. And one of the deep roots in all of my work since the very beginning has been a concern for the Black race. My first play was written with an Afro-American boy who had never been to school and knew no words and was deaf and was going to be institutionalized. Throughout my career, I've always referred to the Afro-American slave and their fight, which was very civil. You take a race of people that were beaten, chained, enslaved, not allowed to read a book except the Bible. But the entire body of music that they produced in the Negro spirituals, which is the root of American music, there's not one song that's protest. There's not one song that's negative. It's about hope. So it's a... That's what I think is underlying in this time, is that the arts can produce a voice that is about hope. And just look at the Afro-Americans who were enslaved and what they did. And so I think it's more necessary than ever, Frank, that artists speak up and do works that bring people collectively together.
Yeah, yeah, and as someone said, the opposite of war is not just peace, it's actually creation. I think your Watermill Center is a place of creation. I asked it, Elise, earlier, but it has always been a global center. You have been a global artist. And what does it, why is that so important to you to actually have had Ukrainian artists over the last decades and from all around the world at your place? What hope are you giving through your center?
Well, I think that the Watermill Center has an open door policy. The central building, there is no door. There is no gate at the entrance of the property. So it's open to anyone to enter. I've often quoted the Bible. The Bible says, "Behold, I set before thee an open door." So it's very important that we, as we have a center for creative thinking, that we are aware of what is happening in the rest of the world. In the United States, we live in a vast country. We know no borders. For the most part, the people in the United States have not traveled. So we don't really know you're German. We really don't know what it's like in Germany. We don't know what it's like in Afghanistan. We don't know what it's like in Granada. We don't know what it's like in with the Eskimos, because we live in this vast country. And so I think it's important that we have some understanding of what is going on in the rest of the world. And I mean, it's embarrassing, but I live in New York State. The New York State Council on the Art, by and large, only funds projects that are in the state of New York. So how narrow and provincial this attitude is.
That's so true. Yeah.
So it's very important that we we inform ourselves. And when we can, is we've always, since the very beginning, since the first day we started the center, we had people from other nations and working together collectively, whether it was gardening or preparing food or working on different artistic projects.
Yeah, it is really, it is an open door, and it has been open for so many artists. Bob, you also write text. It's not as much known. Many of your works, you wrote your text, Civil Wars, but also for Golden Windows, Death, Destruction, and Detroit. You worked with Christopher Knowles. Can we ask you, do you have something for us you might want to read?
Yes, I've selected various texts of Christopher Knowles. Chris was a very young man. He had spent a better part of his life in the Odie Heck School in Schenectady in New York. And he was staying with me in the early 70s. In 1974, Philip Glass and I decided that we would make an opera. And we called it Einstein on the Beach. And I had asked quite early on, after Phil and I decided to make a work, if he would write text for the opera. And I said, Christopher, who is Einstein? And he said, I don't know. I said, come on, Chris, who is Einstein? No, I don't know. I said, Christopher, who is Einstein? He said, let me think. And then he wrote the following, and I'm going to read this. And this is a text we heard in the beginning of Einstein on the Beach. It's called These Are the Days. But it'd get some wind for the sailboat, and it could get these where it is. It could get the railroads for these workers. It could be a balloon. It could be Frankie. It could be very fresh and clean. It could be all these are the days, my friends, and these are the days, my friends. Would I get some wind for the sailboat? And I could get those where it is. It could be Frankie. It could be Johnny. It could be very fresh and clean. It could get some gasoline, shortest one. All these are the days, my friends, and these are the days, my friends. Would it get some wind for the sailboat? And it could get these where it is. It could be Frankie. It could be Johnny. It could be very fresh and clean. It could be all these are the days, my friends, and these are the days, my friends. But it could get some wind for the sailboat, and it could get these for the workers. It could be a balloon. It could be Frankie. It could be very fresh and clean. It could get some gasoline, shortest ones. All these are the days, my friends, and these are the days, my friends. So this is one of the texts that we had. And prior to that, Chris and I performed in Europe. And we were in Paris, and we were in Milano, we were in Rome. We were in Germany, and this was a piece that he wrote. It was called A Mad Man, A Mad Urge, A Mad Giant, A Mad Man, A Mad Giant, A Mad Dog, A Mad Urge, a mad face, a mad man, a mad giant, a mad dog, a mad urge, a mad face, a mad man, a mad giant, a mad urge, a mad face. Maybe that was the piece that the two of us performed. This is a work, a text that Chris performed the loft I had in Lower Manhattan at 147 Spring Street. This is a piece that we performed at 6 o'clock in the morning. And this was a text he and I performed together. I think I love you. This morning I woke up his feelings. I knew he was like silver. So it's good to know that in this thing, it was the kind of thing it is. It could be a reason to know you must not know to shout about when you're walking about on the roof. It was okay. So it was a television onto the stage. I think I love you. I think I love you. I think I'm afraid of, I guess I'm sure. I'm sure about the pupil. This morning I woke up his feelings. I knew he was a little like silver. So it was good to know that in this thing, it was a kind of thing it is to be. It could be some reason to know you must not shout when you're walking on the roof. It was okay. So it was the television onto the stage. I think I love you. That's what I'm afraid of, I guess. I'm sure about a pupil. I woke up with a brain. I woke up with some spring under my bed. So it was the roof. I think I love you. I think I love you. I think I'm afraid, I guess. I'm afraid I'm sure about a pupil. This morning I woke up his feelings. I knew he was like a silver. So it was good to know that in this thing, it was a kind of thing it is. It is that kind of thing it is. It could be reason to know. You must not think about that when I'm walking on the roof. It was okay. So is the television on this stage. I think I love you. I think I love you. I think I'm afraid. I guess I'm sure about a pupil. It was so good to know that in this thing, it was the kind of thing it is. It is the kind of thing it is. It could be reason to know. You must not shout when you're walking on the roof. I'm okay. So it was the television onto the stage. I think I love you. I think I love you. I think I love you. This was when Chris came to stay with me. He lived in my loft. And this was what he said the second night he was with me. I am the red secondary planned up as jet madness in the sky. It would be light. So it was a silver dress into a style to be so hot. It could be madness. It would be real fine checker. It was so mad. It could go mad. It would be so good to style the hair in time. So everything is beautiful on the nest to be alone. It was so nice to be that and to be that too. I am the red secondary planned up pest, jet madness in the sky. It would be light. It was a silver dress into style to be so hot. It would be madness. It be real fine checkers. It is so mad. It could go mad. It could be so good to style in the hair and team. So everything is beautiful on the nest to be alone. It was so nice to be that and to be that too. So onto the group too, a second jar has like very team into a mad jar to deal with me and to deal with me and you too. So everything is beautiful on the nest to be alone. It was so nice to be that and to be that too. I'm the red secondary planned up pest jet madness in the sky. It would be light. It was a real shock. That was the second night he had was staying with me to hear this text. And what is amazing is that, I don't know if you can see this, probably not.
Yeah, a little bit, yeah.
So you can, Elise and Frank, read it many ways. I'm reading just the first word of each line. I, so, it, so, I, so, it, so, I. A, so, I, so, I, it, so, it, so, credits. This is the end of all the lines of the text I just read. It would be light, it would be light to, it would be light, it would be light to, it would be light, it would be light too. It would be that too. So those, you can read it multiple ways, and it's always graphically very beautiful to see.
You can read it from, enter it any direction, horizontal, vertical, below, above. Yeah.
What is amazing about Chris is that when he's typing, there's a rhythm to the little, old-fashioned typewriter that you go.
That's amazing. A typewriter
composing music, and so it's visually constructed, it's audially constructed in terms of the typewriter, and then musically in terms of the text.
Yeah, it's still a manual mechanical instrument in a way, like these weapons of war that are mechanical, but the typewriters are on the side of peace and poetry, like your work is so beautiful, poetic. We have about a minute or two left, but what are you working on now?
I'm in Houston and I'm preparing an exhibition of drawings and video. And I'm directing Puccini's Turandot at the Houston Grand Opera.
Fantastic.
Then I go to Spain, where I'm producing a work with students and non-professionals in the Contemporary Art Museum in Palma.
In Palma, incredible. And then you're not too far away, just 1,000 kilometers or even less, 500, to a war zone. It's incredible. I think this is why your work is so important. It is so shining. I know how much work you put in and how much detail, but more light actually comes out because you craft it so beautifully. And we really want to thank you, Bob, for taking the time to be with us. I know how hard you work and how much it's so meaningful. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good day.
Thank you, Bob. It means the world to us, really. Thank you. Thank you. And before us was BAM, the Brooklyn Academy of Music. And now we go to St. Anne's Warehouse. And I don't know if they are already with us. Elise, thank you so much.
Thank you, Frank. Thank you for doing this. Really special.
And we will have your Itel Adnan poem, where Bob also is preparing about later, another time. But thank you so much. And let's move to the St. Anne's Warehouse.